Belinda and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of Best Seat in the House, A Motor Racing Life, written by Neil Crompton and Aaron Noonan and read by James Saunders. Dedication. This book is dedicated to my true love, Sarah, and my wonderful children, Emma and Sienna. Thank you also to my fellow motorsport enthusiasts for their incredible support over the journey, and especially in the recent past. Special thanks to Aaron Noonan for his undying commitment to the creation of this book. Foreword. Neil Crompton is one of the brightest minds and most trusted voices in motorsports. His diverse experience and his knowledge of the sport provide great perspective, and I've always admired his work and his passion for racing. Neil has the unique ability to look at our sport through different lenses and still focus on the big picture. From his years of experience behind the wheel as a driver to his legendary career as a broadcaster and someone who is still a true race fan at heart, Neil has a great appreciation for what makes motorsports so unique and special. I got to know Neil well a few years ago when he and his company produced a documentary on Team Penske, and I was so impressed by his professionalism, his creativity, and his drive to tell our story in the most complete and entertaining way possible. I am proud to call Neil a good friend, and I look forward to listening to the book and enjoying some more of his great stories and exploits on and off the racetrack. Roger Penske, Chairman, Penske Corporation. Prologue. It was love at first sight and sound. A life-changing epiphany. The prelude was a bone-jarring 10-hour ride from Ballarat in Western Victoria in the back seat of a family friend's Holden Turana XU1. For added fun, the interstate journey was followed by a sleepless night camping under the stars surrounded by drunken goons, too many of them armed with firecrackers, and all seemingly with access to an endless supply of grog. Welcome to the top of the mountain at Bathurst, 1977 style. And then, the following morning, it happened. Winding up the hill on a trailing throttle, it sounded like a car repeatedly speaking Aussie, mate, 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 mate. On a wide open throttle, the exhaust note declared war on your eardrums. The Mazda RX-3 was heard long before it was seen, and then it appeared, dancing, bouncing, sliding over the crest of the hill at Reed Park, slipping past the metal grate and vanishing into the distance in a blaze of raspy glory. I thought I was witnessing a NASA rocket launch. The car was so fast that it took my breath away. After years of pre-dawn, pre-race television tweaking of the brightness, the contrast, and eventually, in 1975, the colour settings, actually seeing and hearing a racing car in the flesh as it tackled the magical winding ribbon of road at Bathurst was a moment of pure joy. I was 17 years old, and I was hooked. Compared to the faster V8 Ford Falcons and Holden Turanas that appeared seconds later, the little Japanese rotary-powered coupe was hardly the rocket I conjured in my mind at first blush. But I thought it was brilliant nonetheless, and the image remains vivid in my memory today. Throughout practice and qualifying, I was awestruck by the passing parade of superstars and their cars at this holy place, and it all led to the great race on Sunday. In those days, self-preservation meant adopting neutral colours. Although I was a devoted Peter Brock fan, it became obvious very quickly that not wearing a Holden or Ford T-shirt meant you could enjoy a form of peace and dodge the abuse handed out to those who dared to support either brand. My Suzuki motocross T-shirt was the perfect attire, except after day three. The naive teenager's guide to Mount Panorama survival in 1977 began with finding a good location from which to watch the race. My chosen position was in the fork of a tree next to the shell tower at Skyline. My bladder was full and my stomach empty. I did not move all day, staring and studying every piece of racing information I could capture. Braking, lines, turn-in points, downshifts, all with a totally uninterrupted view. Here they all were, the legends, my heroes and their iconic cars, all day long. It was heaven. It was the best, if most uncomfortable, seat in the house. As a Brock fan, I was frustrated that his Holden Turana A9X and ambitious three-car team assault, backed by Holden dealer Bill Patterson, was struggling, unable to repel the mighty Moffat Ford dealer's Falcons of Alan Moffat and Colin Bond, who stormed to a crushing 1-2 finish in that year's Bathurst 1000. Thinking about it later, the impression made on me by that Mazda RX-3, and then by Moffat, Bond, Brock and Co. was profound. It left me with a fixation. I had to find a way to get to the other side of the fence. I had wanted to race cars from as far back as I could remember, and that first Bathurst trip sealed the idea in my mind. The problem was that I had no idea how on earth I was going to do it. In that period of my life, sage grown-ups, teachers and other wise souls all like to ask what you wanted to do in life, but I knew what I wanted to be. Despite the dismissive smiles and disengaged chuckles, my matter-of-fact response was always the same. I wanted to be a racing driver. 1. The early years. As a toddler, I would stand and lean in between my parents from the back of the car across the gigantic bench seat while we were driving along and call out all the various brands and models of the cars rattling towards us. At the age of 3, I could spot a Hillman Hunter from a Hillman Imp a mile away. Already, I was perfecting one of the most useless skills known to mankind. Clearly, almost 6 decades later, I've made 0 progress in life. I'm still shouting at cars from afar. Back then, there was no such thing as a compulsory seatbelt. By modern standards, this was crazy dangerous. And can you imagine the boring monologue my parents had to endure from the gibbering kid in the back? Ugh. But ever since then, my imagination has been overstimulated by anything on wheels and anything to do with engines, automation, and performance. I was born in July 1960 in Ballarat, about an hour from Melbourne. It's a town that can be bitterly cold for large chunks of the year. I often say I was born, bred, and snap frozen there. My love of all things automotive kicked in early. The catalyst for my lifelong obsession was probably my dad, Colin. In fact, the whole Crompton household had an automotive vibe. Dad and my mum, Alwyn, detailed cars for various local dealers and, in a wonderfully 1960s Australian phrase, did up cars, buying and selling them in their spare time. That was how they made a bit of cash on the side to pay for the extra trimmings they desired in life. My family didn't come from wealth, so mum and dad had to be resourceful, like many people in the 1960s. Dad worked as an electrician for the State Electricity Commission and jammed in a bunch of other part-time activities, including working after hours at a friend's engine reconditioning shop. He was technically gifted, annoyingly detailed, and frequently displayed a shocking temper. Mum was a stay-at-home mother who added to the family bank balance by doing some bookkeeping work on a part-time basis for an automotive reconditioning parts and accessories business. Before my younger brother Glenn and I arrived on the scene, she had worked for many years in the office at the Beau Repairs Tyre Centre in Ballarat. We lived in Hawthorne Grove in Wenderee, a northern suburb of Ballarat, not far from Lake Wenderee. Our upbringing was typical of a lower middle-class Aussie family in the 1960s. In primary school, I towered over most other kids. Early in the game of life, I was 5'10". Living in that rare air up there meant I had some horsepower to exercise burn, and I ended up being captain of the Wenderee Primary School football team. I played centre-half forward and ruck rover and loved it. I had an unfair advantage and could muscle my way around the miniature paddock, snatching the footy with ease, which was all fine and dandy until the other kids had their own growth spurts, and pretty quickly my swagger vanished. My interest in the game slowed further when I broke a finger battling for a mark. Plus, I really hated how damn cold and miserable it was crawling around in the midwinter Ballarat mud. Cars and motorbikes and anything else with an engine were my magnet, and soon enough, ball sports fell to the wayside. Drawing, reading, talking about, and dreaming of driving cars consumed me. As a kid, the allure of even seeing a race car with a racing number or a driver's name painted on the side of it was a major thrill. So imagine my excitement when Donald Campbell, the British speed record chaser, visited Ballarat with his Bluebird K7 speedboat and Bluebird land speed car in 1963. Even though I was only a toddler, I was captivated by those deep blue machines parked on the back of a pair of open trucks in Ballarat's main street. They captivated many others in Ballarat too, and throngs swarmed to Sturt Street to take a look. The Bluebird CN7, with Campbell at the helm, broke the land speed record at Lake Eyre in South Australia in July the following year, setting a mark of 403.1 miles per hour, a shade under 650 kilometres per hour. To me, motorsport was a dazzling show with larger-than-life characters and extraordinary machines doing amazing things. Those deep blue Bluebirds completely fitted the bill. There were cars and automotive books everywhere in our house when I was growing up. Everything in my world was about cars and racing. And nothing has changed. My love of motorsport today still feeds off that childhood passion. I have a distinct memory of riding with Dad in his Fiat 125. With apologies to Fiat fans, it was a boxy little rust-prone sedan with just one redeeming feature, but it was a good one, a sweet exhaust note. When Dad blipped the accelerator pedal as he down-changed a gear, I thought he was a magician. I loved that sound, and I was intrigued by the technique. Dad positioned his right foot to nudge the throttle with the side of his right heel, while he kept the ball of his foot on the brake pedal. For an impressionable brat like me, this was high art. Most downshifts in a supercar or race car are done this way. It's a bit of a black art called heel and toe, and its purpose is to smoothly harmonise the engine, the transmission and the road speed, so as to avoid the car lurching forward on the downshift and hammering the valve springs or other breakable internal parts. The sound of that car, as Dad drove us around Lake Wenderee, was like a symphony to me. I made him accelerate and downshift repeatedly just so I could hear that music. There were all sorts of cars in our family's driveway when I was a kid. For some obscure reason, Dad had a fleet of go-go-mobile darts. They were everywhere. At various stages, the driveway would be littered with them. White, red, black, blue. It was like they were in a six-pack. Because of that, it was a huge thrill decades later for me to meet Bill Buckle, the man who created the famous dart in the late 1950s and early 1960s. He'd decided to bring out a little chassis from Europe with a two-stroke motorcycle engine tucked into it, and then fit a locally made two-door fiberglass body. They were weird toys, so light and tiny, with an even weirder sideways H-pattern manual gear shift. I still bear a scar on my right shin from an exhaust burn I copped from one of those little beasts when I got too close to the back of the car after one of Dad's hot laps of the block. I'm forever branded like one of my TV mate Mark Larkham's cows on his farm. To this day, I don't know why Dad had so many of them. I should have found a way to hang on to one of them at least. For me, back then, driving past the Chrysler, Ford or Holden dealerships was a very big deal. The competition between the companies was fierce, They'd launch new cars regularly, or facelifts of existing models, fighting bitterly for market supremacy. Car lovers devoured every development. When Chrysler brought out the Valiant Charger, it was a breathtaking, groundbreaking update. Dad and I went to the Ballarat showgrounds and peered through the cracks in the locked metal doors to catch a glimpse of the new model.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.